What's up, friends? Actually got the chance to go to school today and pick up some Toyota stuff so we can make videos during quarantine with real Toyota parts. I'm Jeremy Bramble from Eastfield College. I teach in the Toyota program there. And so today we are going to go through the rebuild process for a 2017 Tacoma transfer case. Okay, so to show you what a transfer case does, it bolts to the back of the transmission here, and then the output shaft from the transmission splines in here. The propeller shaft, or the drive shaft that goes to the rear differential, hooks on here, and power typically goes straight through in two-wheel drive. Okay, when we want to shift to four-wheel drive, this little electric shifter here will shift it into four-wheel drive, and which will cause the front propeller shaft to drive the front differential at the same time as the rear. It also has a low function in it, so if we're going to pull something out of the mud, or we're going to climb a steep hill, or whatever the scenario is, you can shift into low, which will give you a much more torque multiplication than you would normally have. So let's take this guy apart. I've got TIS open up on my computer here. I got most of what I think I need for tools laid out. So let's see if we can't break something. So first thing it wants to do is take off the yokes, the front and the rear yokes. I'm gonna label them just to make sure that I know the difference in them. I'm gonna put an F on that one and an R on that one, and hopefully that'll help me keep them straight. The nuts on these are peened. See how well you can see that. See right there where the nut is peened? We're gonna unpeen that with a chisel and a hammer, which is actually how the instructions in TIS say to do it. So I'm gonna take a pretty small little chisel here. It's flat. Just basically unpeen that nut so that we don't tear up the threads when we take it off on either the shaft or the nut, really. All right. There's a special tool to hold this guy, but hopefully the impact will just take it off. Like that. I'm gonna do the same thing over here. All right. Pair of 32 millimeter nuts. The front one was smaller than the rear. That's kind of wild. All right. Neither one of these want to walk off real easy on their own. So I'm gonna use a three-jaw puller. See if it will work. Never use an impact on your pullers, right? That one came off easy. All right, I've got an O-ring in here to seal oil. And I've got some shims. Check out those little guys. Probably for some sort of backlash. I'm gonna set it on top and do my best to remember where it was. That's the rear. Where's this front one at? Off she comes. Give it. Okay. It's got a rubber seal on the inside of here, like a dust seal, to keep mud and things away from the actual seal that seals in the oil, which is kind of wild looking. I wonder if that one was the same way. Nope, not that one. This one just has a single seal on the other side. All right. And check that out. It has the actual little drive-in seal there to seal the shaft as well. They didn't want the front drive shaft to leak, or front yoke to leak, that's for sure. Okay, flanges have been removed. And this is remove the transfer extension housing. So the extension housing on the back of it wants to come off. Thank you. That's all of them. This guy's held on with, it looks like red FIPG. So it may not jump off of there without some help. Let me grab a different chisel. And let's see if we can't get it to let go. Hey, look at there. All right. So an extension housing is just held on with, or just sealed with form in place gasket. All right, it says to check out our two shims. Then there should be a little spacer in there. So I got those off. I'm gonna stick them back on top of that flange just for fun. All right, now time to split the case. A bunch of 12s or 14s, 12s. Now then, this thing is straight out of the junkyard from LKQ, so it's likely to still have some grease in it, so we may make a mess here in a second. This one has a skid plate that was not on TIS. Gonna have to knock that skid plate off before we can split the cases. Little skid plate for the front side of the shaft or the case. I'm losing pieces that I don't want to lose. Okay. Bolts are out. Oh, except for those two that were hiding underneath the skid plate. Again, this is held together with glue, so it may not jump off of there. It did not say anything about pulling the lock ring off of this bearing, which leads me to believe they want the bearing to come out with it. All right, well, we'll see what happens. I got a nice spot to pry it apart there. Well, that was easy enough. All right. Yeah, I think this snap ring needs to come off. It may make my life a little easier. There we go. I'm not really prying hard, I'm just wiggling. I think if we can wiggle past. This bearing right there, be home free. I'm gonna grab a rubber hammer. See if it'll help a little bit. Oh, there we go. Ta-da. That came apart nothing like the instructions in TIS, but it came apart nonetheless. So, not very much oil in there. That's a good thing. Let's see if we can catch some of that. Make a little bit less of a mess. These these things. This one here uses 90 weight, so it smells really good. Okay, now then, back on track. He wants this oil separator plate removed. So let's yank him out of there. Okay, there's a little tube here. This is a pickup for an oil pump. It's kind of cool, and a lot of these Toyotas have an oil pump inside of them. And it is the cutest little oil pump on the planet. It says there is a magnet right here. Okay. There's a magnet that lives right here in the case to pick up on any metal fuzz or anything that comes off. There's not much on this one, so that's a good sign. It wants to remove the oil pump. Give it. Okay. All right. So let's look at this. This drives off of that right there, which is splined to the output shaft. So, if the output shaft is spinning, this gear is driving this cute little oil pump, causing it to lubricate the transmission or the transfer case. Okay. He wants to pull the O-ring out of there. We're not doing that. Okay. Front bearing retainer here, or extension housing, whatever you want to call it. Okay, nothing to pry on. So I'm going to take my sharp little chisel and give it a little whack. See if it comes apart as easy as the rest of it. Nothing wrong with that. That's awesome. All right, front seal, extension housing cover is glued on again, just like the rear was. It actually does say to remove the lock ring this time. There's a lock ring that holds that bearing into the case. Slide him off. And then we can slide planetary gear set out. So the transfer case for low has a planetary gear set. There's a sun gear in here. The input shaft drives the sun. There's a carrier, which is your output. It's got your planet gears on it right here, just like in an automatic transmission, and they live on a planet carrier. And this planet carrier is splined to the output shaft. And the case has the ring gear, and the ring gear is held to the case. So in normal two-wheel high or four-wheel high, You lock the input shaft to the output shaft and the drive goes straight through. When you go to four wheel low, we'll actually engage the planetary gear set and we'll get a gear reduction after the transmission but before the diff. And that's how low works. So remove a transfer case plug is next. Case and compression spring. It's close to the shifter housing, or what should be the shifter housing. Right there. Oh, that keeps that guy from rattling. We're not taking that out. Most of the time when you rebuild a transfer case, you're gonna put new bearings in it, probably a new chain in it, and then gaskets and seals. but that's really all you end up servicing on these things. So the planetary we're going to leave alone on this one, because if the planetary is bad, it would probably cost more than a used transfer case would to just replace this transfer case. So we'll pretend it's in good shape. Of course it is in good shape. This thing's pretty clean inside. All right. Remove the transfer load planetary gear spline. That's this guy right here. Okay, so a pocket screwdriver is your friend when you're working on transmissions. Lots of lock rings and things. And some of these, you can just pry them out with a screwdriver and they just kind of walk right out, nothing to it. So, drive ring, don't shoot the screwdriver across the room. There's some bearings hidden down in here. There's two halves of a caged bearing. Let's see if I can get the other half out. There's those. That's probably going to be a neat trick to put back together. Another lock ring in the front. I'd like to take the lock ring off. It just doesn't want to come off. It has a number on it, which leads me to believe, I bet that's a selective thickness and it's ground instead of stamped. So that probably sets some thrust somewhere. I'm sure we'll see that later. All right, lock ring is off. Now there's another lock ring. More lock rings. There we go. It's also precision ground. So then we should get a thrust washer with a locating ball on it. Maybe. All right. It's not going to fly. Big chair channel locks might. Oh, that's dude. Little. There we go. Thrust washer. And there's a ball in here that keeps it from rotating. A little magnet will take it off. Magnet may not let me have it back. I had a shim there a second ago. There we go. A pair of shim. Maybe it's one shim. It's one shim. Okay, got that apart. And now this guy should come out. Should. Okay. So this is my sun gear. Also my input shaft. Let's see if I can get this plug out of it. See where it splines. There goes the plug. That's where it splines into the output shaft of the transmission. And this is the input shaft for the transfer case. It's also the sun gear for low. There's a thrust washer behind it that this guy sits right here and spins on. Actually, it sits up there and spins on like that. But. Then there's a caged bearing inside there. To allow it to spin inside this, and a bearing for the planet carrier, and then there's your little planet gears. So when you're rebuilding this bearing here is definitely going to get replaced. Maybe you'll get the little thrust bearings and things, maybe not. It just depends. We're not going to take that one out because we'll destroy it getting it out. Leave it alone. I'm going to scoot that over to the side. Okay, that's the end of that housing. Now we get this mess. So I got two detent balls in here, and they live inside behind these little plugs. Looks like I need about a 6 millimeter Allen to take those off. There we go. Sometimes on those little Allens and Torx on these transmissions, if you'll snap them loose instead of just a steady pull on them, you're more likely to get them apart without tearing them up. So the top is just a plug. Beneath it is a spring and a ball. So a spring and a detent ball. Same thing for this one. That will allow us to take the shifters off of those rails without shooting balls across the room. Now then, there's some lock rings in here. And I'm going to bring you in for a close-up so you can see it. All right. So you see this lock ring right here? The void in it is too wide to put a pair of snap ring pliers on. And the instructions in TIS are to take two screwdrivers, put one on each side of that clip, and then smack the back of it with a hammer. And that is actually the instructions. There's pictures of this in TIS, which is entertaining that that's the procedure. I'll show you how to do it my way. You need a rag, because when you knock that clip off, it shoots into the abyss and never returns. So two screwdrivers, they need to be close to identical, at least close to the same length. And we're going to put them one on each side of that lock ring, like this here. Get my rag set up so I don't shoot this thing across the room. And this is takes a little practice, I'm not gonna lie. Ha! There we go. Goofy little snap ring. They're not that much fun to take off, by the way. I got one more down inside here that might actually be a little easier because it looks like it's kind of tight. All right, I'm zoomed in on another one. Hopefully I won't give you a good shot of the back of my head there, or my ears. And so there's a snap ring right here on this shaft. I'll put one screwdriver on one side, one on the other, and I'm gonna hit it with some force right here and hopefully it'll come off in one whack. Check that out. And there's your lock ring. The rag prevents it from shooting across the room, and life is good. Okay, snap rings off. Now I got a bolt that holds something. Oh, it holds a shaft. There's a bolt down there that holds a shaft. It's a little 12. Just that little fork and that bolt hold the shift shaft in place. It says, remove the forks. Here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna take a picture of how these forks go, because sometimes it's hard to identify which is which and know which direction they go back on. So we'll take a little picture, and that should make reassembly a little bit easier. Okay, remove the transfer case fork shift shaft. It says slide that shaft out. Okay. I got one more snap ring before I can do that. Set my rag back down in here. There it is. All right, redo. It says pull this shaft out, watch for stuff to fly out. Shaft's coming out. That's just a shift shaft. And there's some balls or footballs, pins, something in there. Let's see if we can fish these guys out. I call those footballs. I'm not sure what that's supposed to, what its technical term is. They call it a interlock pin. Footballs. Second football. We've already removed the lock ring that it's telling you to remove. That's the second time it's telling you to remove that lock ring. That must be the typo from the first part. Now then, these two shafts are tied together by this big old fat chain. And if they don't come out at the same time, it can bind up in there, which can take fun out of things. So you want to take your time, wiggle these guys out. And in cases like now, give it a little love with the rubber. There it goes. Okay, so two shift forks. We got our chain, which is what actually drives the front drive shaft, or the front propeller shaft. It hooks across that sprocket there, and it comes across to this one, and then the front yoke actually splines on here, and this chain drives that front yoke. So we'll set him over there. That bearing and that bearing would normally get replaced. Not much to this rear part of the case. You got your shifter there, and you see how much work it was to get to this point to remove the shifter, so that we could remove the shifter. And let's go ahead and take it off, and I'll show you a few things about it. Got another lock ring here, a lovely fun lock ring. Oh, I found it too. I am so lucky. Yeah, so that's what happens when you miss the rag. It shoots it across the room. The shifter is held on with just three bolts. Okay. So this is the motor that shifts this transfer case. It moves this shaft in and out to shift between the gears. This O-ring on it can leak. And on some of these, it has a much larger O-ring, and the housing can crack right by the O-ring and cause it to leak, and you have to replace the shifter. And if you ask the old guy in the shop, he'll tell you how to replace this without disassembling the transfer case. Because the TIS says you have to take the transfer case all the way apart to replace that. But I'm not gonna tell you how you do it. So just rear housing. Okay, now we're looking at this guy here. So this is where all the shifting is taking place. This is the sleeve that engages into the planet carrier for our, to hook the input shaft to the output shaft. You can slide this sleeve forwards and actually put the transfer case in neutral if I ever hit the right spot. So this slides up and down on this hub here, much like how you would shift a manual transmission. So that's what shifts neutral and I guess direct, whatever that disconnects the transfer case. How about that? Okay, I'm gonna try and get this thing apart from the other direction. So I put a puller on here and pulled this bearing loose, and I'm hoping that I can get off the things I want to see without having to take it to the press. That hub was actually on there pretty tight. So on the back side of this, where my chain drive is, I've got a rear bearing that would be normally replaced. I've got a thrust washer with no BB in it. Then here goes my chain drive gear. It's got a cage bearing in it where it lives on the output shaft. Now check this guy out. This one is shift on the fly, which means you can shift from 2-wheel high to 4-wheel high going down the road. And if you look, it's got a double cone, no, it's got a triple cone synchronizer. So there's a cone on the drive gear for the chain. There's a female cone that sits on it. Now then on the outside of that cone, there's teeth. That blocking ring is what that technical term is, or piece of brass. There's grooves on the outside. Now then there's a cone that has an inner and an outer surface for wear, or for friction, that splines into the gear, okay? So now if we look at it separately, the pieces that are turn at the rate of the gear, there's an outer surface of this cone for friction, and an inner surface, and another outer surface. So three wear surfaces, or friction surfaces. So inner blocking ring, second set of cones. My outer blocking ring, which has teeth that spline into the inner blocking ring. And that is a synchronizer that allows you to shift from 2-high to 4-high going down the road. Now then 4-low, never shift on the fly. That's a stop, put it in neutral, and then shift. And then this has a hub and a sleeve with keys and springs, much like a manual transmission does. So that's that part. Easy enough. This sleeve engages and disengages the input shaft to the planet carrier to give us high or low. This sleeve engages and disengages the drive gear for the chain, which gives us four-wheel drive and two-wheel drive. So that's my two sleeves. I only have two forks. And this is my high-low sleeve. This is my 2-4 sleeve. Now then this one will also give me neutral. If it's in between its positions, we get neutral with that one. So that's it for the transfer case as far as pieces go. It's not a sophisticated machine, tool, I don't know what you call this thing. Not a sophisticated unit by any means. It's basically a 2-speed manual transmission. It's got a high and low and a neutral. And then it has 2 output shafts. And then we either run the rear output shaft or the rear and the front output shafts. So that's all the pieces in a transfer case. Next, we'll do some inspection. So, before I get to that, yeah. So, when you do a rebuild, these blocking rings are definitely a wear item. So it's a good idea to replace your blocking rings. You're gonna replace, a rebuild kit always comes with all the big bearings. These bearings here may or may not come in your kit. They don't have a lot of load on them, so they don't wear at the same rate. You're definitely gonna get a new chain. If someone drives around a lot in four-wheel drive in hard surfaces where they should not, it'll put a lot of wear on this chain. And the chain can actually get so sloppy that it slaps the case and makes a really cool noise in four-wheel drive. You can break a chain. That happens a lot. But in my experience, usually a broken chain means a busted case and you need a holding transfer case anyways. So typically you're not going to replace a broken chain. It's gonna be a whole new unit. But that's about it. Of course, we're gonna put new seals in it, front and rear, input, output, all that stuff, all new seals, new O-rings, and re-glue, clean and re-glue all the housings. But that's pretty much it. Okay, we got this transfer case apart. Let's do some inspection on it. First thing TIS wants us to inspect is the diameter of the transfer input shaft journal surface, which is this guy here. And it wants to measure this surface here. Now then in TIS, they want you to measure it with a micrometer. I'm gonna go be lazy and I'm gonna use my dial caliper. And I'm going 1.975 inches. Minimum diameter is 1.874, so we're way above minimum. So that guy's not scary. Same piece, measure the inside of the bushing here in the back. 1.540 is max, and we are at 1.540. So, I don't see anywhere in that bushing, but it might be a good idea to replace that bushing. All right, we want to see thrust play on the planet gears. And maximum clearance is 33 thou. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stack up 33 thou worth of feeler gauges. Let's see. 31, 32, 33. We're going to go there. All right. And we're just going to see if it goes in there or not. And we're not even close to getting it in there on these guys. This one here. This one's almost getting it in there. Not even thinking about getting close. Let's see what we do get. Shoot. What do we got there? That was 18. So 20 won't go, 18 will. So let's call it somewhere between 18, 19 thousandths. And what we're measuring, I'll show you up close. This gear has some thrust washers on the outside of it, and we want to go between the gear and the thrust washer there. So 18 goes pretty easy, 20 won't go, so I'm gonna call it 19 thousandths. Maximum is 33, so I'm not scared of that at all. It wants to check radial clearance on these, and I'll show you the picture of that, and there's just not a scientific way to do that. There are needle bearings inside these gears. If you can feel play, it's probably too much. What's the spec? Standard is 1.5 thou, maximum is 1.5 thou. Okay, so 2/1000 play is bad. So if you can feel play along the shaft of those, that's bad. We'd have to put this guy back together to measure what it's asking for there. It wants thrust. Drive sprocket, output shaft, need a roller bearing installed, no. All right, sleeve to fork. So, they want you to stick a feeler gauge in between the fork and the sleeve like that. In order to do that, you have to have a little set of skinny feeler gauges like this. Maximum is 0.35 millimeters. And I just put in a 0.15 and it was tight. Let's see what a 0.2 won't go. So I'm way, I can kind of get 0.2 millimeters in there. Nah. So we got plenty of service life left in that sleeve and fork. And my other one, which is right here. I can't even get into 0.15. So, max maximum clearance, again, 0.35. So we're good on the forks. What we're checking for is wear right here on these pads on the fork. And if it was too much, you'd replace the fork. But I'm not scared of that. And if a new fork didn't fix it, you'd have to replace your sleeve. And that's it for inspection, except for I got to put all this back together and then check thrust clearance on this gear. And again, it can be done with a feeler gauge. So inspection's done on this transfer case. Everything looks good. Of course, it's probably a pretty low mileage transfer case. It's out of a 2017 model. So let's put it back together. First thing they want us to do is to put this synchronizer together on the shaft, which is kind of odd because normally I would do it on the gear, but we'll follow the instructions and see how it goes. Because when what we have to do is we have to stab that cone or that blocking ring into the big blocking ring. So you just kind of rotate it till it falls in like that. Now then there's three tabs sticking up that are gonna have to line up with these three holes in this gear, which is likely to be the next thing. We're gonna put a bearing on. We're gonna rotate this gear till it sits down on there. All right, I'm happy with that. Now then, I got my thrust washer, which is this guy here. It's gonna go on. Then this bearing goes, the output shaft bearing is gonna go on. I am going to have to put that in the press and press that on, is what's gonna have to happen there. So I took this to the press, pressed on my output shaft bearing there. And we're gonna measure. The actual thrust clearance of this gear. So what you're gonna do is stick a feeler gauge in between this thrust washer and the gear where this gear moves up and down. Let's see what we get. It's way less than 18. Let's try 8. Less than 8 thousandths. I have a 0.15 millimeter. Ooh, looky there. That goes in. 0.20 millimeter in there. 0.2 is just about right. Let me check and see if that's correct on the thrust on that, which is right here. Standard clearance is 0.1 to 0.25. We've got 0.2 millimeters. So we're good. So I got the output shaft bearing installed. I went ahead and did the inspection procedure for the chain drive gear. Now it's wanting me to put this sleeve back, or the hub back on that we didn't remove, which I don't understand why you'd want to remove it anyways, because it's not holding anything else on unless you were going to replace that hub. So I'm going to go ahead and throw my lock ring back on it. Him locked in. All right, now we're down to putting the shifter back in the case. So if you'll notice, they had put grease on this O-ring from the factory so that the O-ring went in without damaging the O-ring, which is a good idea. Now then, if I had put all this in the parts washer and washed it off, and we were putting on a new O-ring, we would definitely put some grease in there. But in this case, I didn't clean this one. So it's going back together with the factory grease. The factory Toyota grease is probably better than what I have here anyways. And we're gonna torque these to 15 foot-pounds. If this were a real real live rebuild, definitely I would torque those with a torque wrench. But since it's just a demonstration, we're going to do without it. This thing's never going back in a vehicle. Now then, the instructions and tests say to put this mean little sucker on here and push it on with a screwdriver. What that's going to lead to is bloody fingers and a snap ring that shoots across the room. So what I'm going to do, show you my way of doing this. I'm going to get my trusty Nipex pliers. I'm going to set it on there and gently squeeze it onto the shaft. And I'm going to hang onto it with the other hand in case it decides it wants to shoot across the room. And even still, it doesn't just want to jump on there. Ta-da! It's on. I don't see how you'd ever get that on with a screwdriver. Now I gotta put that mess back in here. All together at once. So remember I said you gotta take these off perfectly straight in order to get it apart? Well, going back is the exact same process. Just less fun. I gotta get this hub splined on. Okay. I'm gonna take this guy here. Why is that not right? Freaking that hub's not upside down. Shift that fork's upside down. There's your problem. Okay. So I gotta stab both of these forks, this bearing, this, or the bearing on the back side of this, and hold this chain all together all at the same time. It's gonna be fun. If I did this on a regular basis, I would definitely make a jig to hold all this stuff. Or I could just assemble it and then slide the case down on it. But because it'll sit right there, just nice and comfy. Okay, forks in there and the way they go. I'm not gonna have to go back and look at my pictures because I kind of remember how this goes. I'm gonna stab fork number one. Stab fork number two. Loads of fun. Well, I tried to stab fork number two. There we go. Okay. Got my forks lined up. Now I'm gonna try and put all these shafts back together. This is probably a two-man job. Don't be mean. This is actually the only part of this job that I don't really care for. Come on. Get on there. Okay, we're close. Wiggle this shaft. Wiggle this shaft. This one, wiggle the forks, wiggle some more, wiggle some more. Ooh, that one bottomed out. That sounded good. I can see the groove for the lock ring, and that's how to put that in there with comic effect. If you ask me, that's the only hard part of this whole scenario, was putting that right there together. So, it wants this lock ring on right here. Just to keep, not that lock ring, this lock ring right here to keep that shaft from coming out. Don't really need the tool to put it on. You can just walk it right around. Okay. Now it's time for some super fun snap rings. A snap ring here and a snap ring that's still on there. That's good. So the next snap ring is going to go right here. Sticking on. Got my pliers set good. Hopefully it'll just go right on. Be nice. Ta-da! One snap ring. It's time to install some footballs. So if you notice, there's a groove on that shaft right there. The hole in here where the football goes sits in that groove. Then there'll be another one that's hidden down here that you can't see, where that other football goes. So all you gotta do is fish this guy down in that hole without letting it fall out and line everything up all at once. I think a little bit of grease is probably going to help in this scenario. So I'm just going to put a little grease on my finger and on the football so that I don't lose it while I'm fighting with this. You could probably do this with a magnet, but you don't want a real strong magnet, because then you, every time you try and take the magnet out, it's going to take the football with it. And this right here is not something that's real photogenic. To show you how to do that down in that little hole. One football. All right, I can get my pinky in there for number two, and I can get my screwdriver for number two. So here goes football number two. I'm actually going to stick this one to the end of my screwdriver and maybe not drop it. Where's my long pick? So I got those stinking footballs in there. I may have to correct that earlier statement that that might be my least favorite part of this. Actually, the trick was turn it right side up and let gravity put the pins in the hole. Sometimes I'm just not that bright. So, got those guys in the hole. Now it's time for the second shift shaft, which is this fella here. It has some grooves in the end where that little fork went to hold it to the case. So it's easy to know which one goes where, or which end goes where. We'll have to slide this fork up to that groove to get the ball to let everything slide through. Next piece is our little fork and his bolt. That one again, torque it to 14 foot-pounds. Click. All right, more snap rings. Yay, snap rings. All right, so what you missed off camera is I installed the two little lock rings on that shift shaft there. It's really impossible to video with my hands in the way. And actually, it turned out it was easier to take the bolt and that clip out and slide it out here so I could put the little lock rings on just away from the forks, which was easier. So let's jump to what's next. Okay, so our detents go back in. Our two balls go back in the holes of the forks, two springs, and two little caps to compress all that. Let's see where my socket is. What are we torquing these to? 14 foot-pounds. You heard that click, right? All right, it wants to put the planetary stuff back together. Let's drag it back over here. Okay. So, we get a thrust washer that goes in here, or a thrust bearing, excuse me. There's the one of the races for it on the shaft already. And we're gonna slide this guy in here. And if you'll spin it, it's more likely to go in on its own. And I wanna set it on something. Keep it from falling out of the bottom, just to make my life easier. So we have that little ball that goes in here, and a couple of washers. The inner washer, see if we can't locate our little ball. And if he doesn't want to stay in his hole, I'll put some grease on it. All right, there's a groove in that thrust washer that lines up on that ball, and the ball keeps it from spinning. And now we get our snap ring. We're gonna roll this guy over, and I gotta install these bearings in there and make them stay. So in the interest of reducing future headaches, I'm just gonna put a gob of grease on these. Actually, you can still see some grease, check that out. See that grease from where they did the exact same thing at the factory? Of course, they don't tell you that in TIS. Let's see. Apply transfer oil to the output shaft needle roll bearing and install. Yeah, transfer oil my foot. They put grease on it. Okay. So down in the bottom of there is where those two sets of needle bearings go. We're gonna set. Does this guy have a name? The low gear planetary spline piece. It's called a piece. Reinstall the piece. Well, I think we did that. And it's held on with a lock ring, and we'll just walk it in. All right, these lock rings, you're gonna start one side and give it a twist and compress it all at the same time, and they usually just walk right in. So you really don't even need tools most of the time. Just like that. All right, one more lock ring over here. Maybe. Not real happy with the way that one sits. I'm just going to give it a little tap in, make sure it's in its. Ooh, that looks better. If it doesn't snap into its groove on its own, give it a little help. Okay. This guy goes back into this case here. And giving it a spin will probably help line up these gears like that. Fibbing snap ring on this side. Just rolls right on. Okay. It says to replace the seal in this extension housing. And then reinstall. This surface here I would clean very well and then clean it with some brake cleaner, and then we would, same thing for this surface here, the other mating surface, and then I would glue this back on with the red FIPG, the transmission form in place gasket. This is the way that would normally go on. Torque them to 8 foot-pounds. That doesn't go very much, does it? Because these are little bolts and they go into aluminum. So see if it says to put in fibbing. It says apply adhesive to 2 or 3 threads, and it says use the genuine adhesive or 3-bond 1344. I have a tube of that somewhere. I just don't know where it is. It's the little red thread sealer stuff that Toyota uses, and it's pretty awesome stuff. Anywhere where threads might leak oil out, it'll stop that. Again, if this were a live rebuild, we would use a torque wrench on that. I'm using a wimpy little 12-volt impact here because we don't want that to leak or come off. And if you put too much pressure on them, you'll pull the threads right out of the case. All right, oil pump. Okay, the world's cutest oil pump. Just sits down here. No O-rings, no nothing fancy. It says to put a new O-ring in it before you put everything back together. 66 inch-pounds. So that's not very tight. Just giving it a little bit. My magnet needs to go back in this little trough. Put him in. Of course, you would clean that. There's your pickup screen. You definitely want to make sure there's nothing on the screen. Put some lube on this where the tube goes into the oil pump so we don't damage the O-ring on the install. Press him down in his little hole. Okay. Another 66 inch-pounds. Not very tight. All right. So we would clean this surface, and we would clean this surface really well. Get all the old sealant off of it. And then I usually go through and with a clean rag and brake cleaner and wipe them down, so that I know that there's no oil residue left, and then we would glue this guy back with the red form in place gasket, and it says to use a 1.2 millimeter diameter bead. So really not very much. And if you notice the leftover that's coming off of this thing, this was a brand new transfer case, never been taken apart. It has very little sealant on it. It doesn't take much to seal this guy up. Two nice machined aluminum surfaces. There's no pressure on anything inside it. So should be easy to put together, or easy to glue. All right, now we're gonna fight these two monsters together. So all we gotta do is line up this shaft in there with those bearings, line up this bushing, or this shaft with this bushing, teeth on this sleeve with the teeth on that thing they called the piece, this shift shaft, and this bearing into the case all at once. That's all we gotta do. So no forcing, lots of wiggling, some turning, and you'll usually get there. We'll see how easy this thing goes together. We put grease on our bearing to hopefully not lose it on that needle bearing. Let's see how we do. Come on, darling. There we go. All right, let's see if we can. There he goes. Just the right amount of wiggling. Okay, put some bolts in. 21 foot-pounds. Right. Luckily, these are all the same length bolts, so it makes life a little easier. Again, if this were a live rebuild, we'd go ahead and torque those with a torque wrench. All right. On this shaft, we get a thrust spacer. We get a couple of thrust washers. And then the front yoke that has its own little O-ring in it, which is kind of, we should probably put the probably follow the instructions. All right, we're gonna glue this with another 1.2 millimeter bead. Of course, we're gonna clean this up and put a new seal in it. Line up my bolt holes. You know what, since this thing has to be clocked, it might be a good idea to mark it after you clean it. Then you could take it off, put your glue on it, and glue it on without messing up your bead of Fipig on it. Okay, and let's see, do these get stuff on the threads? Yes, these do get glue on the threads to seal the threads from leaking on these, or keep them from vibrating out, whichever one it's for. Okay, and 9 foot-pounds, not very much. Okay, so we got that guy on there. Okay, and a flange, and we torque it to 94 foot-pounds. Sounds like a lot. You would need the jig to hold that we did not use when we were taking it apart. to be able to reinstall it and torque it to the spec. Again, we're going to use my air torque wrench here. That feels like 94 foot pounds. And then we would go ahead and peen our nut again. But I'm not going to do that just because I don't really need to on this one. Okay. Next flange goes on. This one has a seal instead of an O-ring, which is kind of wild. I don't know if I've ever noticed that before. And this one only goes to 87 foot-pounds. That's kind of interesting. Same nut, different torque spec. And then we would go ahead and peen that guy. And that's it. It's a transfer case. Let's get these boards out of the way. You can see it and we can spin it. That's that. So it spins nice. Nothing scary there. You have to put it in the vehicle to test anything because it's this electrical, so you'd have to plug this in and be able to shift it. But other than that, we're good to go. So if you're interested in making some money in a essential field, look us up at EastfieldCollege.edu. If you want to make some real money working on Toyota stuff, look us up at t-ten.com. And I'll put the links to both of those in the description for the video. All right, thanks for watching. Like and subscribe.